My name is Nilesh. In this video, we are going to see a start of a series based on one of the questions which I asked the viewers of my channel. So if you have been a constant visitor to my YouTube channel, you would have seen that of late, I requested the viewers to vote for the topics that they would like to see. And in the recent survey that I did, I requested them to choose one of the topic, and among them, the first topic which came out with the largest number of votes was 15 factor applications or 15 factor apps. So I'm going to start a series where we will see what are the different 15 factor apps or the principles related to 15 factor apps and how do we use them in our development. So let's get started and see why do we need to understand 15 factor apps and what they really are. So let me start this screen sharing and let's go into a presentation mode. So we are starting this series today, which is the 15 factor apps. To get started, let's try to understand why do we need 15 factor apps. Before we go into the 15 factor apps, let's understand one of the commonly used terminology or methodology, which is called as the 12 factor apps. So what is 12 factor apps? 12 factor apps is a methodology which is proposed by Heroku, which was the cloud platform where they were deploying a lot of services or software as a service. And the engineers or developers who were deploying this hundreds of applications and they were doing multiple deployments, they came across a series of common patterns which can be used to build highly scalable and resilient applications. So listed here are the 12 factors which was published somewhere around 2012. And since then, this has been used as a guideline or a best practice for developing microservices, which can be used to deploy onto, let's say, public cloud or hybrid cloud for that matter. So this helps us to develop applications which are portable and which are highly scalable and resilient. Let's look at these 12 factors. So starting with the code base, this says that any application which uses the 12 factor methodology, it should have one code base and everything is tracked within the version control. You can have multiple deployments, but as an application, there should be only one code base. The next one is about dependencies. Any dependencies that an application uses should be explicitly declared and they should be isolated. Third one is about the configuration. The recommendation is to store the configuration in the environment. Fourth one is about the backing services. So anything that application uses as a backing service, let's say a messaging platform or a database, this should be treated as an attached resource. The fifth one is about the separation of build, release, and run. We should strictly separate the build cycle from the run stage or build stage from a run stage. The next one is about the processes. In order to scale the application, we should try to develop it as a stateless process, and each application should have a separate stateless process model. Port binding is the next one, which is to expose the services via port binding. In terms of scaling out, when it comes to the concurrency, the recommended approach is to scale out via a process model. Then we move on to disposability, which is to maximize the robustness of the application. And this helps in the fast startup and graceful shutdown. Then we look at the dev and prod parity, where keeping the different environments that we have for an application, be it development, staging, production, or QA testing, they should have been similar in terms of as much as possible, or they should be as close as possible to the production environment. Next one is about the logs, where we treat logs as a series of events or a stream of events. And finally, the admin process. So if we have any process which is one-off process, like an admin or management task, those should also be run as admin process instead of creating them as one-off tasks. So these are the basis of the 12 factor apps. Now, this was, as I said earlier, published time almost a decade ago in 2012. As cloud development or the cloud environments became available, public cloud, and people started moving from normal monolithic applications to microservices and deploying them onto the cloud environments or hybrid environments, there were some changes which came across as part of these best practices. And that is where the additional three factors came into the picture, or they came as a recommended approaches. These are API first, where we define the service contract in the beginning. And then the consumers of the API, they can work with that API, while the producer or the creator of the API can work in its own direction. As long as they adhere to the contract, the consumer can do their own testing and they can go ahead with their own development. Next one is around telemetry, where we monitor the processes and performance. This is where the modern day CI/CD comes into the picture, and the tools like Prometheus, Grafana, they help us to monitor the application in real time. And finally, the authentication, where we should secure the application. I have a mistake here. It's a copy-paste error. It says it's the admin process, but it should be about securing the application and data. I'll correct it in the next demo. So these are like the best practices, recommendations, or the principles which are followed or which are recommended in order to build very portable applications. Using this, we can build applications which can run on bare metal, it can run on a virtual cloud, or it can run in the public cloud. And these are not specific to a particular programming language. Since these are like the principles, they can be applied to any programming language, just like the design patterns that we have. This is like the design principles. And since they don't mandate a particular technology or a platform, they can work across technologies, across tools. So in today's session, we will look at a couple of them. It is not possible to cover all of them in one go. And I also intend to build a small demo application, either myself or I will pick up some application which is available on GitHub, which follows all these 15 different practices. And I will use that as a guideline or as an example to demonstrate some of these things. So let's get started with the first one, which is the code base. For the code base, during my two decades of career, I've seen different versions of source code, different approaches being used to manage the code base. But of late, I think Git-based code repositories have become more or less a standard. You have things like GitHub, which allows you to host the code publicly using GitHub as a service, or Git as a service using GitHub. You might have used within the enterprise other things like Bitbucket, or you might have used GitLabs. All these are Git-based repositories. It is very popular and almost a de facto standard nowadays when it comes to managing the source code. The idea of the code base here is everything should be in version control. So if you look at the source code, initially developers were quite familiar with storing everything in the source code. But then there was a differentiation when the application was deployed. The ops team or the team which was managing the production environment, they might not have everything in source control. So in order to avoid this drift between the configuration and the code, it is recommended that anything that is related to the application be stored in the source control repository. So this involves configuration settings. The icons that I've put here are like the HashiCorp Vault and Terraform. But the tools doesn't matter as such. Even the source code I put for the demonstration purpose, the icon of Visual Studio Code. But you can use any source code editor. It can be just a plain Notepad or Notepad++, or if you're coming from, let's say, Java background, you could use IntelliJ, you can use Eclipse. If you are from Python background, you can use PyCharm or any of your preferred editor. The choice of tool doesn't matter here. The idea behind this Codebase as a central repository is anything related to your application is versioned, and you have a track of what happened. How did the application evolve from day one till it went to production, and even after going to production, whatever changes you are doing regularly to that application, everything resides within the source control. So that is what is put here below in the points or the bullets which are highlighted. The version control system, like it tracks all the changes to the 15 factor application. There is only one code base per application. This is important for the manageability point of view. If you have, let's say, an application which is built using small microservices, each microservice should have a separate code base. That allows you to scale that microservice independently of other services, and it helps you to maintain the code better. So you can have multiple deployments. So this comes to the right side of our diagram here. The source code is only one, but you can deploy different versions of your application to a QA environment, to a staging environment, or to a production environment. So let's say, for an example, you might have version one running in production. Your staging might be running version 1.1, and the QA might be doing 1.2 version release of your application. So the source code as such resides in the same Git repository, but you have multiple versions of that. And these versions can be deployed into different environments. Here we have shown only three, but you might have even more than these three environments, depending on the complexity or size of your application. So that is what we say in the last point there, that the app is same across all deploys, but the different versions can be active for each deployment. And in today's modern day CI/CD based or continuous integration, continuous deployment or continuous delivery kind of setup, the main source or the starting point is obviously your source code. That is where your build starts. That is where your deployment starts. So I think if you are not using source code, it is impossible nowadays to do CI/CD deployment. But there was a time when I started my career, people used to have source code stored in different folders with different timestamps, and then files used to get transferred over shared folders or shared files or even using email. I don't think that is the case nowadays, but in case you are still somewhere in the legacy and you're not using a source control and you want to use these principles related to the 15 factor app, the first thing that you will need to do is to move to a central, or not a central, version control system. Git is a distributed version control system. There used to be central systems like VCS, or when Visual Studio was there, there was a Visual Studio related source control system, which was a central one. But nowadays, since most of the providers are using Git, Git is a decentralized system. So in the past, I have seen in my experience that there used to be code bases which were specific to an environment. So you had a branch or you had a repository which was pointing to, let's say, a QA environment, or which was pointing to a production environment. Nowadays, with again modern day tooling, with the better practices that are being followed, this is not the case. I see that you have things like trunk-based development, which allows us to have one single code repository, and that allows us to have different versions of the code. So the gist of this code base is, if I were to summarize, have one source code repository for one application. With that, let's move on to the second one, which is the dependencies part. Now, the dependencies is kind of specific to the programming language, I would say. The way we describe dependencies can vary based on the kind of language that you use. But most of the modern day programming languages now, they have a dependency manager or a package manager solution which comes with it. Or if it is not coming by default, we can use these as an add-on or as an extension. I've taken a couple of examples here. The first one on the left is a .NET Core application, which uses the project file or CS proj file to describe all the dependencies. These are the external dependencies which the application is using. So I have package references here, which are serviced or which are provided by the NuGet package manager for .NET or .NET Core for that matter. On the right hand side, we have the POM file, a snippet from a Java Spring Boot application, which uses the project object model or POM file for describing the dependencies. So here we see two dependencies being described. One is the Spring.OpenAPI UI, which has a version of 1.5.9 and the Sentry Spring Boot starter dependency, which is having the version 5.3.0. So by specifying these dependencies for the application and a specific version of that dependency, what this allows us to do is whenever we set up a new machine or a new developer joins the team, it allows us to have a very deterministic build. So if I take this project file, if I close the repository from, let's say, a Git-based repository, and I try to build it using whatever is my build tool. In case of Java, it could be Maven. And if I run the Maven build, because I'm using a very specific version of my dependency, I know that if it works on one machine, it would work the same way on another machine. In the old days, there used to be cases where, like .NET, for example, there used to be files which used to be installed in the global assembly cache, or GAC, which was called in the earlier versions of .NET, where these dependencies were implicit to the system, and they were considered to be part of the system installation itself, and the .NET framework could use them. But the problem with this is if you upgrade the version of your .NET from, let's say, version 2 to version 3, or now there is a .NET 5 and upcoming .NET 6 version, some of these dependencies, if they are system-wide, they could cause problem when you move from one version to the another. So to avoid these kind of problems, what the dependencies section of the 15-factor app or 12-factor app tries to do is, it explicitly states what are the dependencies that a particular application has, and it tries to isolate that. By doing this, we can have two different applications. I will take the example of Java. Say, for example, application one uses 5.3 version of the Sentry dependency. There could be another application which uses 5.4 or 5.5. But by isolating those dependencies to application-specific dependency, we are able to use both these different versions of the same binary or same dependency on the same machine or on different machines. So that is what the dependencies section of the 15-factor app states, that we should isolate the dependencies for an application, and each application should explicitly state what are its dependencies. And usually this is done via the dependency declaration manifest file. It could be the POM file in Java, it could be the CSproj file in .NET. I think if you are from Python background, then there is the requirements.txt. For the JavaScript-based framework, they have their own way of managing the dependency. But either way, whichever programming language you use nowadays, they provide a ways and means of specifying their dependencies. So with that, we come to the conclusion of this video, where we covered two aspects of the 15-factor apps. The first one is the code base, and second one is dependencies. In the future videos, we will look at the remaining 13 factors. So I hope that you found this video useful. Do let me know in the comments if you have any suggestions, recommendations, and if you find this useful, please hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, and keep the likes going. Thank you. Thanks for watching this video.